this.
John, and as you can well imagine, we're in the middle of a crisis here. Apparently some kids on the internet thought it'd be funny to hack the whole show. So somehow they hacked into, I guess it's this computer, I don't know which one. That just pretty much prevented me from showing you any new or recent games. So for the time being, you guys are going to have to bear with me as I go through some of the archives until I get this problem straightened out. So let's get started. Point, I would not review any more Mega Man games for the NES after the fourth one, because, not for nothing, there's really no place to go with this guy. But then I realized there's probably a lot of skeptical people out there who need to be convinced that Mega Man should have quit while he was ahead, and Mega Man 5 should not have seen the light of day. Here's why.
The fifth adventure to star a much-loved robot hero hasn't much to offer this time around. Even if you're a huge supporter of Mega Man, there's not a whole lot to dazzle you in Mega Man 5. Here's the skinny on this game. Dr. Light has been taken by Proto Man. Well, certainly looks like him with that stupid scarf, but keep this in mind, we've all been fooled before, especially in the fourth game when it turned out to be Dr. Wily anyway. So, I don't think I need to draw you a diagram, alright? Convinced that Proto Man has turned to the dark side, Mega Man treks through 8 stages with a robot boss at the end. Where have we done this before? Honestly, there really isn't anything new you can do other than that. But with a fifth adventure, there must also come 8 more dumbass names for the robots. There's Starman, Napalm Man, Charge Man, Stone Man, Crystal Man, Wave Man, Gravity Man, and Gyro Man. Robots that did not make the cut were Anthrax Man, Surf Man, and American Idol Man. Neither one of the real 8 robot masters have any real useful weapons. If you defeat Wave Man, you get a water wave. That's exactly what I want Mega Man's cannon to do, become a broken garden hose. But like in every Mega Man installment, some of these weapons are able to defeat some of the other bosses. Otherwise, they're pretty much useless. You still have that dog helping you out, you know, Rush. All you're getting though is the usual Rush Jet and the Super Jump that he provides. No Rush Marine, Rush Roller Skater, Rush Scooter. You do, however, have something different. A bird named Beat. This can be unlocked when you collect all the letters that spell out Mega Man 5. Each letter is scattered throughout the game. Once this bird is called upon, it will follow you around wiping out your enemies, even those hard-to-reach ones. It's handy, but I'm sure that this feat could have been put into one of the robot boss's powers that you acquire. The graphics didn't get much of a change in Mega Man 5. It still got that mechanical, futuristic feel to it, as well as a nice-looking forest level and the ability to walk upside down in the Gravity Man stage. But otherwise, nothing new here. Same goes for the sound. Fans will still dig the sound. It's the same as it was on the previous Mega Man Adventures. The music is decent, but doesn't set a good enough mood for some of the levels that you'll visit. The effects are still cool and are untouched. You can't really go wrong in that department, folks. Now, control wasn't much of a problem in this game. Some of the gaps actually require you to hold down the A button hard to make a long enough jump, otherwise you won't make it. But making our hero jump, shoot, and slide overall is just fine. The difficulty of the game is what really stands out. No wonder they keep giving me so many extra lives in this game. It's an extreme struggle just to get to the end of some of these levels, because the enemies are almost literally on top of you, making it hard to get a clear shot, which makes for some discouraging gameplay and a disgruntled player.
Mega Man 5 is not a game I want to spend the rest of my life playing. The difficulty of the game, plus the fact that this is the fifth installment in the series, lead me to the conclusion to toss it. Anyone who plans on asking me to do the sixth game is just asking to have their face shoved in a pile of their own feces. Good night.
When aliens invade an underpopulated Hicktown, it falls to one lone hillbilly to save the day. The game is Redneck Rampage for the PC, and if you play this first-person shooter before, you know that these aliens mean some serious business. That said, here's some cheat codes to assist in the hunting and killing. Let's arm our hero with all the guns that he can carry. Just type in RDGUNS on your keyboard at any point in the game. To activate the ever-popular God mode, type on your keyboard RDELVIS. And finally, for pretty much everything in the game, keys, items, etc., type in RDALL. Simple, does the job. And I've done my job here. Here are those cheats again so you can write them down, folks. Alright, to get all the weapons in the game, type in RDGUNS on your keyboard. To activate God mode, type on your keyboard RDELVIS. And finally, to get everything in the game, keys, items, whatnot, type in RDALL.
Alright, go to town, Bubba!
Hi. I really don't know what else to show you. I mean, I'm running a virus scan right now. No telling what's going on with this thing, but, you know, once things are back up and running, hey, we got some new reviews probably somewhere in the system. But, I guess while we're waiting, I came across an old issue of Nintendo Power from December 91. This is an interesting letter that I came across. Figured I could read that and kill some time, you know? What else do you want me to do? Well, just listen, because this is interesting. My fantasy game system would be a complex 512-bit system. It could display 27,876,992 colors at one time and could play any game from any game system that ever was or ever will be. There would be a miniature band inside that knew how to play any song. You could even buy a special chip that would allow you to make your own games for it. What game would come with the system, you ask? Super Mario Galaxy. This is interesting. Who would have thought that 15 years after this letter was published that we'd actually have a game called Super Mario Galaxy, huh? Yeah, Super Mario Galaxy, better known as Super Mario Bros. 24. You're not far off, kid. The system would come with six 27-button controllers. You're also not far off there, because we're getting there slowly, and would cost $259.95. Price is close too, I'll give you that. I would call it the Roar Power System. Oh, who cares? Folks, I don't know what else to do. As long as this stupid virus scan is running, as long as there's some kind of a virus rampant throughout my system, I really... Wait a second. You know what? I may have something we can do. Something for video vision. Give me 1 minute, watch this, I'll be right back.
Get the power to move with the Acclaim wireless remote for your Nintendo Entertainment System. The Acclaim remote gets you mobile in a WrestleMania grudge match. Flying Airwolf, the Acclaim remote's rapid fire mode means higher scores per mission. In the battle for Iron Sword, seconds count. So you need a controller with a look and feel you already know. Accurate up to 30 feet. The official wireless remote controller, licensed by Nintendo, created by Acclaim. Get the Acclaim remote, the power to move.
This will not to of shows over the years that review... There's been lots of shows over the years that review games, such as the folks over at Game Life and the Mighty Justice Gaming Show. But you don't see a whole lot of shows these days that give you game strategies or even tell you how to win at your favorite games. Thanks to the internet and the growing number of gaming magazines, there really isn't a need for this on VHS or DVD. But in 1989, videotapes began showing up as rentals, showing players how to win at their favorite NES games. Now there's two types of series. The first in this series is called Secret Video Game Tricks, Codes, and Strategies. Now this is the only one I have, but I'm pretty sure there's more. It's just hard to find these puppies, you know? Now this tape gives you tips on how to win at your favorite games, such as Gradius, Contra, Blaster Master, Adventure Island, Karnoff, Akari Warriors, and lots more. These tips are performed by the U.S. National Video Game Team, and their hairstyle and outfits just scream the 80s. And look, if you watch the end of that tape, you can actually see that the so-called U.S. National Video Game Team isn't really playing the game and performing these tips. They're just holding an arcade stick in front of a pre-recorded demonstration of the game. Next on the list is the Game Player's Game Tape. There are about 10 in the series, I believe, and each of these tapes highlights at least 4 or more video games and gives you a complete walkthrough of the whole game. The announcer on this tape didn't really do it for me, because his personality is just kind of bleh. Just listen to him for a bit.
Your next destination should be Zebu's Cave. To get there, travel to the north. Before leaving the village, though, make sure you stop by the tool shop and pick up the alarm flute. Use it to wake up the sleepyhead in the cave. With the special key he gives you, you'll be able to start the windmill and discover a new cave. Do this, and Zebu will share a valuable secret.
I guess back then, not many people cared about how the announcer sounded, as long as they got some general information about the game, such as tips and walkthroughs and little secret passageways and things like that. I think nowadays we're a bit more selective as far as what kind of personality we want for our types of shows. By now you're probably thinking, why am I showcasing these tapes if I'm only going to bash them? Well folks, they're a part of history. There were people out there who wanted to help out other game players, but they just went about it all wrong. Now, if you do happen to go for these types of videos, you can probably pick them up on eBay, and odds are you'll only be spending less than $5 for it.
Mamma mia!
Hey, well I don't know what happened, but now we got our computers back up and running and we can bring you some new content for Grumble and Glorify this month. For 10 years we've watched them make fun of horribly made B-movies. Now today the gang from Mystery Science Theater 3000 have taken their extremely funny commentary into your living room once again. Let me show you what I'm talking about here. I got queued up here the horror film Halloween on DVD. Below that is a specially made MP3 called Riff Tracks done by Mike Nelson and Kevin Murphy. Now I'm just going to play a little bit of it here and I'll come back with more information on Riff Tracks, but for now, watch this.
See, putting on a mask and a jumpsuit and hanging around schoolyards. It's Michael Jackson.
Yeah. Who does their lawn maintenance? Carl Spackler?
You know, in fairness to the bullies who tripped him, It is pretty dorky to bring your pumpkin to school.
I agree. Okay, if that's supposed to be his point of view, he's got long arms because it looks like he's driving from the back seat.
Aside from mechanics and pilots, I do think it's good to have a healthy fear of anyone who wears a jumpsuit.
That would explain my inordinate terror whenever I see Neil Diamond.
Well, in that case, it may be due as much to turn on your heart light as it is to the jumpsuit.
No doubt.
Hey, kid, want to buy the answers to Mrs. Greeley's third-hour spelling test?
Well, that kind of went nowhere, didn't it?
Right.
Starting to distrust the tension music as an accurate predictor of terror.
Yeah, it seems to signal long stretches of non-action.
Oh, man. Okay, here's how this works. First, you go to the RiffTrax website, www.rifftrax.com. Now, the catch is this. You have to actually download the RiffTrax off this website, which is about $2.99. Totally fair price. Next, you have to actually own the movie. Or you can rent it, borrow it, download it. No, you didn't hear me say download. You don't want to download the film. You want to support the movie makers. These aren't the droids you're... Anyways, since this is a feature on Gremlin Glorify, it now falls to me to review it. Now, don't let the fact that I am a huge fan of MST3K make you think I'm going to be biased and say, yeah, go get the RiffTrax and buy the movie and whatever. Even if you're not a fan of the show or never even heard of these guys, it's still worth your time looking at the website and checking out some of the samples. They've done movies such as Star Trek V, The Matrix, The Grudge, and even Star Wars Episode I. Yeah, take that, Jar Jar Binks. Overall, I strongly recommend checking out RiffTrax. And hey, if you own the movies that they're riffing on, you're in luck. And $2.99 is a great price to pay for an entire movie full of jokes and commentary. And some of them were done by Mike Nelson alone, and other films he's gotten Kevin Murphy and even Bill Corbett to join in. Now, I haven't laughed this long in a damn long time, and I guarantee you'll bust a gut when you check out RiffTrax.
Before Spider-Man hit the consoles with games based on the hit movies, he had a cool adventure on the Nintendo 64, Dreamcast, and PlayStation. And it's the PlayStation version of Spider-Man that we got cheats for this month, so check them out, folks. When you get to the main menu, select Special, and then Cheats. Let's get started with some unlimited webbing. The code for that is STRUDL. To enable some really weird stuff in the What If contest, enter in GBHSRSPM. Care to unlock all the levels in the game? Sure you do. Just put in XCLSIOR, and every level is accessible. Invincibility is as easy as putting in RUSTCRST. You know, I might as well spoil everything and just give you everything. Enter in Stan Lee's name backwards. That would be EELNATS. And you'll unlock all the comic book covers, movie cutscenes, costumes, the works. Alright, go have some fun, play around the game a while, I'll post the cheats across your screen so you don't have to rewind again. Alright, at the main menu, select Special and then Cheats. Now for the unlimited webbing, enter STRUDL. To enable the What If contest and get some really weird stuff, enter GBHSRSPM. If you want to unlock all the levels in the game, put in XCLSIOR. For invincibility, put in RUSTCRST. And finally, to get everything in the game, including comic book covers, costumes, and movie cutscenes, enter in EELNATS. Enjoy!
Alone at last. Let us end this, Spider-Man.
Alright, now that we're back in business, I can review a more updated game. This one came out in 2005 for the PC and Xbox, and it's called Stubbs the Zombie. Yeah, Stubbs. Not really what you think it is. Here's what it is.
Stubbs the Zombie plops you into a future where it looks like the 1950s, but it's filled with all sorts of conveniences like robots and cool-looking monorails. Interesting concept. Probably take the time to see what kind of TV shows they got in this particular future. Waking up 20-some-odd years after you, well, sort of died, you now play a zombie who wanders around like a drunk on a Friday night. You'll be helped in the beginning of the game by this guide bot, who basically does the job the instruction manual should, and tell you how to play the damn game. You'll have to endure little training sessions where you learn how to eat people's brains, give them a zombie bitch slap, and expel the kind of fart bomb that can blow a hole through a sumo wrestler. All these lovely abilities are yours to use in 12 levels, which take you all through the town of Punch Bowl, Pennsylvania. Yeah, that's the name. In this game, when you eat the brains of the town's inhabitants, they become your zombie friends and can serve as a human, well, they used to be human, zombie shield. Or they can fend off your attackers, which a lot of the times are cops, soldiers, doctors, and
hillbillies.
I haven't yet caught on to the real objective of this game other than to turn the whole town into zombies, win the heart of a girl, and maybe change the name of the town. You'll learn a few moves as you progress throughout the game. There are 4 total, and you've got such abilities as pulling a gut from yourself and using it like a grenade. You can throw out your hand and possess a soldier or civilian, or expel one giant noxious fart cloud. It does help you in the game to rally as many zombie friends as you can, because there'll be times when you have to gather the lot of them to knock down a huge door, or they'll actually help you take care of some of the bad guys that are giving you a hard time. There will be a dancing contest and a chance to pilot a vehicle or two. Stubbs the Zombie is pretty okay. It's a nice concept, but what almost turned me off at first is the tutorial in the beginning. Every minute is a scene where you're being taught the basics of the game. This is stuff you can find in the manual, folks, but when was the last time you actually thumbed through one of them, huh? The graphics are pretty neat, and you might dig the retro future environment. The sprite animations look good enough, and the cutscenes don't aim too much for realism, so I like. I think the voiceovers could have used a little bit of work, but they got the zombie moaning part down alright. Not a whole lot of music. You'll be doing most of your zombie assimilation in silence, though listen for a few classic songs done by modern bands. Otherwise, not much happening in the sound department. Control of this game really confused the hell out of me. From the looks of it, you can control Stubbs with the left analog stick, but in order to get him moving in a general direction, you have to manually adjust the camera angle with the right analog stick. That's a bit extra work for myself and probably other game players. When I was driving one of the vehicles early in the game, I had to apply the gas with the left stick while steering with the right. Couldn't just one of these sticks do the job? If you can't handle my bitching about that one little detail, then you're watching the wrong show, folks. On to the challenge. Most of the people who have completed this year-old game claimed it was too short of a zombie adventure. I'm halfway through and it took me many lives to get this far, even with the skill level on normal. When it comes down to fighting the soldiers and doctors and whatnot, they take no prisoners, brother. They'll fire machine guns, laser guns, bazookas, you name it. See, this is where possessing these bastards really comes in handy, because you'll need to use brains in this game, but since you're playing as a zombie, it's probably best to rely on your own brains.
I'm not doubting this game in the least. It's got its good moments here and there, and I laughed a bit at some points, but other times I just wanted to scream because of the control flaws, the insane challenge, and the agonizing, horrendous load times. That said, I'd say try it, at least. You might think it's the greatest thing since sliced bread, or the worst thing since Paris Hilton's sex video. Who knows? Alright, it's about time we wrapped up this month's show. Now, if you got questions, comments, death threats, drop by our message form at www.vmtv.cjb.net. Sound off, tell us what you like to see on the show, and we'll do our best to accommodate you. I'm just glad the computers are back up and running, but I don't see how blood got all over the main PC, but at least things are back to normal and all's right with the world.
Mario.